Welcome to Beacon Church, a light to our neighborhood, a beacon set on a hill. We aim to be a beacon of God's good news in Handsworth and wherever He places us to live and work. We are here to demonstrate to others the good news of Jesus Christ, to restore life, rebuild community, and build up the body of the church in love, so that all are actively involved in the task. Go, be fruitful, and multiply.
Good morning. We started a little bit early this morning, so welcome if you're online and you're wondering what's happening. It's great to have you with us. We're just going to have 2 minutes of silence for us to remember and to pray. Traditionally, Remembrance Sunday is for remembering the two world wars, people who lost their lives to bring freedom. But today, I think we all want to remember conflicts around the world and people who are suffering today, especially those that are really on our mind at the moment, in Israel, Palestine, in other places around the world like Ukraine, but that's not the only ones. Let's pray as we spend these couple of minutes in silence. We've gone over the 11 o'clock, but we're going to be quiet now for 2 minutes just to remember the people who are suffering and losing their lives and going through so much at the moment, and to pray for peace. Father God, as we come in this strange moment to you, it seems hard to imagine the pain, the suffering, the fear, the grief, the hunger that so many are going through, even right now, and so many have been through because of war. Lord, it's hard to remember that just a couple of generations ago, bombs were falling on Rookery Road. Bombs were falling on this road. Bombs were falling around Birmingham. There were neighbours who were there one day and gone the next. There were houses in rubble and ruins, because that's what war does. There were people in hospital whose lives have been changed significantly forever. And Lord, that's happening all around our world. And we ask for your help. Ask for your help for those who are struggling right now, those who are suffering these terrible things right now, those who are in grief over their loved ones that they've lost, those who are in pain because of their injuries, those who are having to fight because perhaps they have no choice, those who are seeing death every day, And we say again, Lord, will you be the peacemaker? Will you bring peacemakers to bring a stop to these things? This morning we especially give you what's happening in the Middle East, in Israel, Palestine, and ask for your help, your power to bring a halt to the hostility, the blood feud that is going on. And Lord, we ask for peace in Europe too. We ask for peace in areas of Africa that are ravaged with civil war and with insurgencies. Ask for your peace. We ask for your life. For you said, blessed are the peacemakers. They shall be called sons of God. It's your desire for there to be peace. You are the Prince of Peace, Lord Jesus. And we pray for your kingdom to come, your will to be done here on earth as it is in heaven. In your name, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. I'm now going to hand over to your host for the morning. Hostess, Stacia, who's going to lead us in this first part of our service.
Good morning. Okay. Are you feeling cold this morning? Ooh. We've had such lovely weather, haven't we? For the few months, unusually lovely weather. I want to welcome you this morning if you're joining us for the first or for the second time, or you haven't been here for a while, I want to welcome you. I want to welcome you online if you're joining us as well for the first or however much time you've been joining us, we want to welcome you. We pray that this morning you will feel comfortable amongst us. We might be dancing and singing and clapping our hands. That's what we do. It might feel a little bit strange to you, but it's okay. You can join in as well. You can join in if you feel like you want to clap and dance. Because we come this morning to give God praise, to give him thanks, to worship him because we acknowledge him as Lord. We acknowledge him as Savior. We acknowledge him because he woke us up this morning. As simple as we're awake this morning. Hallelujah. Are you agreeing with me this morning? Can't hear you. Feel like I'm alone up here. Okay. I want to just draw attention to a few verses of scripture this morning. And I'm going to be reading from Romans chapter 8. We're reminded, I was reflecting on Kamala's being dedicated this morning, and it just reminds us of, well, it reminds me of, there's a few scriptures before where Jesus said, suffer the children to come unto me and forbid them not, for they are such are the kingdom of God. And I was thinking, we get a fresh reminder this morning that we are to be like children, aren't we? No? Adulting is a bit overrated, don't you think? Paying bills, making decisions. But we're told in the word of God that we are to be like children with his guidance. I'm going to read from Romans chapter 8, verses 35 to 39. So I'm going to read from the New Living Translation, and it says, can anything ever separate us from Christ's love? Does it mean he no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity or persecuted or hungry or destitute or in danger or threatened with death? As the scriptures say, for your sake we are killed every day. We are being slaughtered like sheep. No. Despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loves us. And I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today nor our worries about tomorrow. Not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above or in the earth below, indeed, nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Jesus Christ our Lord. Wow, do you feel love this morning? Do you feel love this morning? So regardless of where we're coming from, what our stories are, we're reminded by this word this morning that God loves us. If you're here today and you've never heard that before, God loves you. He loves you. Doesn't matter how you look, doesn't matter how where you're coming from, doesn't matter what your story is, he loves you. Amen. People of God, God loves you. Do you want to shout hallelujah to God this morning? Hallelujah. Praise your name, God. Even when we feel unloved, unworthy, we don't look like the church folks, we're meant to do certain things, please be reminded this morning that God loves us. Amen. I'm going to open in prayer, and then I'm going to invite our worship team to lead us, to help us to sing some songs in here this morning to give God praise. Lord, we want to thank you. Thank you for your word, God. Thank you that your word is yes and amen. We want to thank you for the reminder this morning that nothing can separate us from your love. And then as children of God, children that you have created this morning, we want to come in surrender, in submission to you this morning, accepting the love that you're offering us, God. Lord, we pray that all that is mentioned this morning, that no ear would hear words of condemnation, but what we would hear is your love administered to us this morning. We pray that you will have your sweet way this morning, God. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. So you ready to do some praising in this house? Hallelujah. I'm going to invite the worship team to come. Don't feel shy amongst us, okay?
Good morning, Beacon Church. And good morning to visitors who are here with us today. We've come to worship the Lord. That's what we do. We are not ashamed by the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that is another way that we worship, is through song. If you're able to, I'd like you to stand. The song that we're going to start with is called Today, Lord, I Will Lift Up My Hands in Praise. Each new day that we've got breath in our bodies, each new day that God opens our eyes, it's the day where we can praise him. So that's what we've come to do. Amen.
Today, Lord, I will lift up my hands in praise. Today, Lord, I will lift up my hands in praise. For I know you are always there for me, Almighty God, Almighty God. You are my trials come my way, I will praise you, Lord. Today, Lord, I will lift up my hands in praise. Today, Lord, I will lift up my hands in praise. For I know you are always there for me. Almighty God, Almighty God, you are my all in all. No matter what I face, When trials come my way, I will praise you, Lord.
Let us sing that one more time today.
Today, Lord, I will lift up my hands in praise today. Today, Lord, I will lift up my hands in praise. For I know you are always there for me.
Almighty God,
Almighty God, you are my all in all.
No matter
what I face, when trials come my way, I will praise you, Lord.
No matter
what I face, when trials come my way, I will praise you, Lord.
No matter
what I face, when trials come my way, I will praise you, Lord.
Amen. You know, we serve a God that no matter what we face, that we can call on our mighty Father God who is with us. Amen. I'm going to continue to worship him. The song says, I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame, and I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. The joy of the Lord is our strength, the joy of the Lord that comes from Almighty God. And you know, the songs that we're singing here, the songs that Kay chose, that she wanted these songs because she wanted us to give God glory. She wanted us to lift him up, and they spoke to her. So that's why we're singing these songs, not just for that, but also because God is worthy to be praised. He's done so much in our lives, and we want to just give him and testify of that. So let us worship him.
I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness, I'm trading my pain, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord.
I'm trading my sorrows.
Joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sickness, I'm trading my pain, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord.
And we sing, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord,
yes, Lord, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes,
Lord, amen.
I'm trading my sorrows,
I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord.
I'm trading
my sickness, I'm trading my pain, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord.
And we sing, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord,
yes, yes, Lord,
yes, Lord, yes, Lord,
yes, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. And we'll sing, yes, Lord,
yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen.
From the top, I'm trading my sorrows.
I'm trading my sorrows. I'm trading my shame. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. sickness. I'm trading my pain. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. And we sing, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. And we sing, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, 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 Lord, Lord, amen. Yes, yes, Lord, amen. Yes, yes, Lord, amen. Yes, yes, Lord. Yes, yes, Lord, amen. One more time. Yes, yes, Lord, amen. Amen, amen, amen. You know the word amen, it says yes, and I agree that we're going to trade our sorrows, we're going to trade our pain, we're going to trade our shame for the joy of the Lord. Amen. Let's continue to worship. We're going to sing a hymn, and most of you, I think, would know it. It's nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Amen. Again, it goes back to what we just sing about trading shame, trading all the things that the enemy will throw at us for God. Amen. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my pardon this I see, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing this my plea, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing can for sin atone, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Naught of good that I have done, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my hope and peace, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Oh, precious.
Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing. nothing but the blood of Jesus.
From the top, nothing. What can wash?
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Oh, no other found I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
For my pardon.
For my pardon, this I see. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing, this my plea. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing can for sin atone. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Not of good that I have done. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
I want to hear you singing, oh precious.
Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Oh, no other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
This is all.
This is all my hope and peace. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Oh, precious,
oh, precious is the blow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
Did you enjoy that singing and worshiping? Yes? Are you convinced that nothing but the blood of Jesus? Yes? Nothing but the blood of Jesus can save us. Hallelujah. We are going to do things a little bit different this morning. I'm going to invite Sunday Club to go at this point, and then we will come back a little bit later. We're going to be singing some more songs, so don't get upset a little. We're going to sing some more songs, okay? We're going to be singing some more songs and worshiping. So if children, if you're here and you want to go to Sunday school, you can go. Sorry? Okay. Can go if you want to. It's fun, it's not like in here. Nobody's gonna force you to stand up and clap your hands. Okay. I'm going to invite Pastor Tim to come at this point and bring the word.
Oh, well, welcome again, and welcome if you're online to our Sunday morning worship service. Very special today. We've got lots of visitors who come to celebrate the birth and life of Camilla, and we're going to be praying for her and blessing her later on in the service, and also praying for those who are part of her life. But I wanted to speak for a little bit. I was thinking about parenting. I was thinking what it means to be a parent and some of the challenges that you go through. And do you know what? Despite all the best laid plans of the things you want to do and the things you want for your children, life doesn't always go like that, does it? It doesn't always go as you want. There are so many self-help guides, parenting books, classes you can go to. And when you start as a parent, you think, oh, I've got all these plans. I know exactly what I want to do. And I remember when we had our first child and he was just still a baby, and we decided that we were going to feed him the healthiest diet possible. And we bought a book. Of course, you buy a book, don't you? What can I feed my baby that would be really healthy? And there were all these wonderful recipes in there. They were incredible. You know, involved mainly pureeing vegetables and fruits and all the rest of it. And do you know what? He wouldn't eat a spoonful. Every recipe we tried, he spat it out. And I think to this day, certainly into his teenage years, where he said whenever he ate vegetables, he felt like he was being poisoned and they tasted horrible. So that didn't really work, did it? The best laid plans, the best manual, do you know what? Life doesn't conform to a manual. And you have to be prepared for all sorts of things and all sorts of seasons in your relationship, in your life with your children. And because every season's unique, and every child is unique, and every child has got something uniquely special to bring into your life, to bring into the life of the people around them, haven't they? And that's why we're coming today to pray in advance for Camilla's life, because we want to see him work in her life. So don't expect the Bible to give you an exact one-size-fits-all 0 to 18 guide for perfectly raising children. It doesn't. It doesn't. Or does it? It certainly says train up a child in the way that he should go. Even when he's old, he will not depart from it. That's one of the Proverbs, isn't it? We've heard that one before. And it says also things like do not withhold discipline from a child, which is good advice. We choose carefully how we give our discipline, but giving boundaries for our children is really important so they've got a framework and a structure for their behavior in life. So those are good practical points of advice. It tells fathers not to be harsh with their children, or they may lose their relationship with them. And if there's one verse from Proverbs in the Bible that struck me as I was thinking about parenthood, and it's this one. Proverbs 13, verse 20 says this very short proverb, whoever walks with the wise becomes wise. Whoever walks with the wise becomes wise. But the companion of fools will suffer harm. That's an interesting one, isn't it? I don't think it's quite talking about having a mentor or having a coach, but it's that kind of thing, isn't it? But walking with the truly wise, people who are putting into practice the good principles of life. And the Bible really tells us that the best way you can raise your children is to be an example to them in your own character, your own values, your own principles. And you get that simply by walking with God. If you walk with God through the days of your life, if you will put your trust in him and choose his values, then you're not going to be perfect. You're not going to be perfect. Certainly, you're not going to be anywhere near perfect as you start off on this walk. And we won't be in this life. But the Bible tells us that we simply need to walk with the one who created us and loves us and knows us intimately. the one who knows the plan for our lives that will help us to live the best life that we can, to be the most amazing people that he designed us to be. And his desire is simply for us to be with him through our walk in life. And I want to just read a parable now that Jesus told, which talks about this whole area of parenting. And I wonder if, Entando, you're able to get Luke chapter 15 and verses 11 to 32 up on the screen for me. That would be really good. Thank you. Luke wrote this account of Jesus' life. And at this point, when he was talking about Jesus, Jesus had been under fire from the religious people. They were very strict. They were very authoritarian. They were very upright. And they were criticizing him day in, day out, because he mixed with people that they didn't like. He mixed with prostitutes. He mixed with people who were effectively thieves, people who were encouraging what they thought was a terrible lifestyle. And yeah, that some of them changed an awful lot as they met with Jesus. But he was meeting with those people. And so the religious leaders were just saying, you cannot be the real thing, Jesus. You cannot be the real thing. What about us? Why don't you come and spend time with us? Why don't you show us your powers? Why are you spending all your time with these people? You know, if you spend your time with them, you know what's going to happen? You're like the unwise, the foolish person who spends his time with fools, and you're going to come to harm. So it says that Jesus told a number of stories, parables, to explain why he was doing what he was doing and why he mixed with people that were really having a struggle in life. Okay, so we're going to read this. And he said, there was a man who had two sons. So we take it that he's a father, okay? He's a parent. He's a parent with two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me a share of the property that's coming to me. And he then divided his property between them. And not many days later, the younger son gathered all that he had and took a journey into a far country. And there he squandered his property in reckless living. And when he spent everything, a severe famine arose in that country. And he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out. The word means he joined himself to, almost like what they had in those days, a bond servant, just a minimum wage, if that, so that he could live. So he hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him into his fields to feed pigs. So I won't use the word, but he was in deep pig poo at that point. Okay, you got it, haven't you? That's what Jesus is saying. That's what Jesus is saying. Don't use the words, but that's what he's saying. The worst place he could be in. And he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate. No one gave him anything. He's starving. When he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread? But I perish here with hunger. And I'm going to get up. I'll arise and go to my father. I'm going to go back. I'm going to say to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion and ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. He rehearsed that really well, didn't he? He rehearsed that bit. You know, have you ever done that? Have you ever got in your mind what you're going to say to try and make it up with someone and say sorry? And you kind of, it's a hard conversation, so you go through it in your head. I've tried that so many times and I always forget. He did well. The father said to his servants, bring quickly the best robe. Put it on him, put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. In other words, treat him as a prince. Treat him as a prince. Treat him as the son that he was, because he is that son to me now. And bring the fattened calf and kill it and let us eat and celebrate. They're going to have a feast. He's here. For this, my son was dead and he is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to celebrate. Now his older son was in the field, and as he came, drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, your brother's come and your father's killed the fattened calf because he's received him back safe and sound. But he was angry and refused to go in. His father came out and entreated him. But he answered his father, look, these many years I have served you and I've never disobeyed your command. Yet you never gave me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends, never mind a fattened calf. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him. And he said to him, son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. It was fitting to celebrate and be glad, for this your brother was dead and is alive, was lost and is found. And that's the end of the parable. I think you can see that what was happening there was Jesus was talking to these religious people who've been criticizing him and saying, you're a bit like the older brother, you know. In this story, you don't understand. You don't understand God's love for you. You don't understand the position of privilege that you have. And you'd rather not join in with this amazing celebration I'm having as people who have been far away from God, who've been dead to him and dead to you and lost, are now found and alive, and they're celebrating with me and we're eating together and we're having an amazing time. But you're on the outside because you're so religious, because you're so wrapped up in the things of human beings and religious practice, that you can't see the life and the love of God. It's an amazing, amazing story, isn't it? It's a story about a parent, first of all. So it's a story about a very gracious, fair, and loving, amazingly loving father. And he represents all parents. And he's also a father in pain in this story. His heart is broken by his child's decisions, actions, and attitude. Child who thinks he knows best, knows what will be good for him and what will make him happy. And to be happy, he knows he needs to be as far away as possible from his dad and his family so that he can get on doing the things he knows they'll disapprove of. Because he knows while he was with his family, he was walking with the wise. He was taking in everything he saw from them. So he knew that what he was doing wasn't right, but he had to be far away in order to go and do it. And he spent everything that he had. Did it make him happy? Was he happy at the end of all that when he had done everything he wanted? I don't think so. He was in the deep dirt, wasn't he? He was in the worst place that he could be. And he discovers that he's wrong. He has nothing left of any value. Nothing at all. And he's in desperate, desperate need. So he sells himself as a slave to this farmer and ends up in this horrible, smelly place. So hungry, he wants to eat the food that the animals are being fed, the pigs are being fed. I can't even imagine doing that, trying to scoop up dirty pea pods from the ground and pinch them from the pigs. He must have been so desperate. And then the penny drops, doesn't it? The penny drops. Maybe I didn't have it so bad back where I was. You know, maybe, you know, even if I'd been just a servant in my father's household, I'd had bread to eat, I'd been safe, I wouldn't have been smelly, I wouldn't have had to work with pigs. I'd have been well off compared to this. So what can I say? What can I say to my dad if I went back? Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Yeah, even if you don't want me back as your son, I realize what I've done is not right. I know. Will you take me back just as a servant so I can just be in this family again, in this household? Not even in the family. He wasn't asking to be made a son again, was he? He was just saying, you know, just will you take me back as something so that I can live? And what we see is a compassionate father, a loving father who reinstates him as a son or more. Sticks the ring on his finger, cloak around his shoulders, celebrates with a feast and kills the fattened calf, which was saved for a special celebration. Calls everyone together to a party and says twice in this, why are you doing this? Well, this is my son. He was dead, but now he's alive again because he's come back to me. He was lost, completely lost, and now he's found. I have got to celebrate. So I want to tell you, first of all, as we read this, we learn that God is not the person, the being that we are told that he is by so many people. He's not far away. He's not sitting there in judgment on you, wanting to just make life difficult for you, turning around at every opportunity to say, oh, I told you so. You can't get things right for even a day, can you? That's not God. There's a word in the Bible for that. It's called accusation. And do you know what that name is for the accuser? The accuser, that word means, well, Satan means the accuser. Satan's doing that to you all the time. If you're hearing those words and you're thinking God's like that. This is the God who said to the Son, first of all, yeah, okay, you want to try things out your way, I'll let you have everything that's yours. He gave him the free choice to make his own decisions. This is Father God, who is amazingly compassionate, loving, looks at you as a child that he wants to come back to him. Do you know, this younger son made his own decision to walk away and walk with the foolish and not the wise. And eventually he did become wise. He came back. In this parable, Jesus amazingly compares Father God with a father whose child has rebelled against the wisdom of his parents. Now, it wasn't a comment on God's bad parenting, I don't think. Do you think it was a comment on God's bad parenting? I think he was saying, well, it's all his fault as a parent. Look what he's done. He's let this child go off with the household silver and all the money and everything that he could have. No. No. Whilst he was growing up, he was walking with the wise. He was with a family that knew God. He was with a family that loved him and had the great values and had all the future ahead of him. Bringing up children is amazing, but it can be a heartache. And you don't know what decisions they're going to make in the future. You don't know, and you can't control that. But you know what you can do? You can walk with God. You can walk with the wise, and your children will see you and see your attitude and see your values in practice and see your relationship with him. And no matter what else happens, they will have that in their mind, imprinted on their mind, so that should they come to that position later in life where they need to make a better decision than the ones that they've made, where they break your heart and run away from you, where they do things that you would have been horrified in the past and know that they would end up doing, they will still know the right way. They'll have a map to get them back to the right place should they choose to do so. And you know, that's all that we can do with our children. That is the best thing we can do, is to walk with God, to spend our life getting to know him. But how can we do that? You know, because this parable is saying that all of us are a bit like the son that went off. All of us are a bit like that. And the Bible says very clearly, doesn't it, that that all of us have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. It's not just saying, hey, all of us have done things wrong. All of us have messed up. What it's saying is that all of us, none of us actually lives up to be the amazing person that God wanted you to be. None of us lives up to be like that. And God has got this picture. He's got this plan. He's got this route for your life in which you can become the amazing person that he designed you to be. We can't do it on our own. A lot of people will criticize Christians because they say, well, you know, you Christians, you just say you can be forgiven for everything. So you can go around and do whatever you want. You can do all the things that God has said, don't do that. You can fail to do all the things that God has said, hey, you should be like this. You can do whatever you like, then you can come back and say, hey, Jesus, forgive me. But you know, that's not the point. That's not what it's all about. That's precisely what it doesn't say. There is a price to be paid for all the bad and foolish decisions that we make. There's a price to be paid for our selfishness, our sin, as the Bible calls it. And that's the price that we see here in this parable. For this father, the price was the that half of all that he ever owned and had, he gave it all up for his son. He gave it up for his son. And then when his son came back, he received him again. Why doesn't God act more justly, some people say? Why doesn't God just punish us for the sins that we've done, for the things we've done wrong? Because there's a huge price involved. Why doesn't he just do something about it? When is he going to come and judge those who are slaughtering other people, those who are abusing other people, those who are stealing what is not theirs, those who are making life a misery for others? Why doesn't God come and judge them right now? And the truth in the Bible is that if he came to judge them right now, he'd judge all of us. Because it says all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. All are in need of forgiveness. And the only way that forgiveness could come was if the Father paid the price. He didn't ask his son to pay it all back. He freely accepted him. And he took the price on himself. And that's Jesus. That's Jesus as well, isn't it? God is not fair. God came into the world. This is what Christians believe. This is what the Bible is saying. God came in the person of Jesus. The Bible says he is the exact image, the visible image of the invisible God. The Word of God made flesh. We don't understand it. It's not our place to understand it. He knows how he does it and how he did it. He came as a man and he gave his life up in the most horrible way, on a cross, suffering, crucified, tortured, in shame. And it says that he bore our sins. He took the price in his body on the cross for us. That's why Jesus could welcome so many people who had done so many terrible things. He had people amongst his disciples who were thieves, who were terrorists, people who had not lived up to their own parents' standards, certainly. People who had made other people's lives a misery. He had them there. How could he do that? How could he accept them? Well, he knew he was going to give his own life in their place. He was going to pay the price so that he could be just as gracious as his Father. And you know what? That's the whole crux of it. That is the crux of the matter. We have a choice. We can return and we can say, you know, God, I was wrong. I don't deserve your love. I don't deserve to be your child. But will you accept me nevertheless? And if you do that, you will find a compassionate Father waiting for you. A compassionate Father God. And he wants you just to be with him. You can make a new start. That's what Jesus spoke about so many times. That's why people came to him with all their problems. Because they could make a brand new start. And they could be, if you like, born again on the inside. Forgiven, accepted. He says he'll place his own spirit, his own mind in you so that you begin to think like him. So that as you walk with him through life in a relationship, you will begin to change. You will begin to become the person God had in mind for you to be. And ultimately, that will be the greatest blessing for your children. If you are a parent here today, that's the ultimate blessing, because that Holy Spirit of God living in you produces all those qualities, all those godly qualities that make life worth living. Love, joy, peace. And don't we need peace? Patience, kindness, gentleness, self-control, compassion, love. Boldness and braveness to be a courageous person who lives for what is right and who makes a difference, a blessing, is a blessing in other people's lives. So, will you walk with God? Will you walk with the wise and become wise, as the proverb said? You have a choice. Nobody can make it for you. But before we carry on, before we worship a little bit more, before we dedicate Camilla back to God and ourselves to looking after her as she grows up, let's pray. Briefly, let's pray. It's a holy moment. You can pray to the living God today. You can pray to that fire that Jesus was talking about. And you can just say these words. God, I'm sorry. I've just decided to go my own way. I know it's not right. I know I struggle with it. I struggle with it. I don't know what to do. But I'm coming to you because I know that if you accept me, I can be different. I want to thank you that you came into this world in the flesh to suffer, to die, to pay the price for me. But you rose again. I don't know how it works, but I just ask that you will accept me as your child. And you'll forgive me and give me a new start. That you'll put that spirit of yours in me so I can think, that mind of yours in me, so I can think like you. I can see how you see things. I have the strength to overcome the temptations I have every day and the struggles I have in me. I can be like you. Thank you. Thank you that your Bible, your word says that that's what you do. Thank you for this parable today that's helped me understand what you do. Please come in and change me. That I may live for you all the rest of the days of my life and become the person that you designed me to be. Amen. Amen. We are a church of a very joyful people that love to sing, to celebrate. We also love to just sit with one another and read God's word and help each other to grow. So if you really feel that you're in need of him today, and that prayer and that passage in the Bible has really struck a chord with you, just come and have a chat with one of us afterwards. Just say, you know, that was really good. You know, how do I know more? How do I find out more? Which bits of the Bible do I read to find out what it means to follow him? And we'd love to talk to you about it and just maybe just pray a blessing on you today. So I think we're going to sing again before we have the dedication. So worship team, are you still around? Could you come and help us? Another song that's been chosen for this morning, which has words that really echo a lot of what we've been talking about, how he is here for us, fighting for us, and with us to lead us through life.
Then can you stand with us, please? And also, we're going to collect the offering as well. Please don't feel obliged to give if you're here, but if you want to, then that's it, then you can do that as well. So please stand with us as we sing Victor's Crown.
You are always fighting for us, heaven's angels all around. My delight is found in knowing that you wear the victor's crown. You're my help and my defender. You're my savior and my friend. By your grace I live and breathe to worship you. At the mention of your greatness, in your name I will bow down. In your presence fear is silent, for you wear the victor's crown. Let your glory fill this temple, let your power overflow. By your grace I live and breathe to worship you. You are ever interceding. As the lost become the found, you can never be defeated, for you wear the victor's crown. You are Jesus the Messiah. You're the hope of all the world. By your grace I live and breathe to worship you.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You have overcome. You have overcome. Hallelujah. Stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome. You overcome. Every high thing must come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome. You overcome. Every high thing must come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome. You overcome. Every high thing must come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome. You overcome. The cross, the work was finished. You were buried in the ground. But the grave could not contain you, for you wear the victor's crown.
Hallelujah. Let us worship him.
Hallelujah. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome. You overcome. Every high thing must come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome. You overcome. Every high thing must come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome. You overcome. Every high thing must come down. Every stronghold shall be broken. You wear the victor's crown. You overcome. You overcome.
Hallelujah, we worship you. Every high thing must come down. We give you the glory. We give you the praise. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord. We thank you that every high thing must come down when we serve the Almighty Father God in this place. We give you the glory. We give you the praise. We give you the honor. Hallelujah. 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 Every high thing. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
go. Just wanted to welcome you again. It's great to see everybody here. I can see some people I haven't seen for a long time, and lots of new faces. Thank you for coming to support Kay and Jamie and family and everybody, and Camilla especially. We come to that point where we're going to pray and we're going to dedicate. It's not just, you know, dedicating Camilla back to God, because we'll do that. We pray for blessing in her life. But it's also taking time ourselves to think, what's your part in her life? What's your part in supporting this family to help her life to be the best that it can, to help them in times of stress and trouble? So, and as a church, what we do is church family, we like to also make our own promises as we pray and pray for this family. So I'd invite you to come up, if you'd come and join me, along with godparents, anybody else you've invited to come and stand with you. That would be great. Come and join me. I think Camilla's well and truly asleep at the moment. That's okay. You can come stand anywhere around me, that's fine. And I'd like to invite Elaine to come and join us too. I don't think Philip's here. I think Philip's out in Sunday Club. Yeah. Come and join us. Come and stand on the side there. There you go. I'm sorry I'm blocking you so people can't see you, but you probably don't mind. That's good. So I'm gonna ask a question first, actually. So here's Camilla. What can you tell us about Camilla for those that don't know her very well? What's she like? Is she really quiet all the time?
No.
What's she like then?
Very loud, very vibrant. Loud and vibrant.
Loud and vibrant? Yeah. Oh. You're not going to be too loud and vibrant today, though. Maybe. Okay. Anything else you'd like to tell us about her? You don't have to. Any thoughts? That's okay. Well, it's rather early in her life to know what her full character is going to be like. But we've heard a few things and seen a few things over the weeks and months. We've seen her character, and we've heard her talking, very happy, and trying out lots of sounds and words. And I'm sure she knows what she means, but we haven't quite got there yet. But soon, I'm sure she'll be intelligible and very intelligent. Jesus said these words, which are worth remembering. He said, don't be anxious. Do not be anxious. What shall we eat? What shall we drink? What shall we wear? He said, for the Gentiles seek after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them, and need them all. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. And it kind of goes back to what we were saying earlier on. Walk with the wise. Walk with him. Walk with God through your life. Anybody supporting a family, supporting a child as they grow, walk with God, and he'll give you the wisdom. It says that if any of you lack wisdom, you should ask, because God will generously give it to you. It's a lesson that Christians have come back to again and again, that if we want to live in the fullness of life that Jesus promised to his disciples, we've got to put him first in everything and walk with him. And the other things kind of fall into place afterwards. That's really tough. And I know that I don't do that every time that there's a disaster, or every time that there's a terrible thing happens, or I'm really anxious. Most of the time, yes, I can remember that I need to come back to him and put him first. But there are times when I don't, and it takes me a while to get there. But he's been so good, so good. Too often, I think we do take actions out of our own insecurity and try and make things better ourselves, try and grasp hold of things that we think will satisfy and solve our problems. But Jesus said, let God have the first place. Try to live his way and don't spend your time worrying about everything else. Each day has enough worries of its own. So I'm really pleased that by bringing Camilla here today, what you guys are really saying is we want to present her to God. We want to get this right in the first instance. saying, Lord, in Kamila's life, you take first place. We know that that's going to happen. If you put him first, then she will see him in your lives too. What you're saying also really is, you know, Father God, will you provide for Kamila every step of the way, in every season of her life, in every phase of her journey through life? Will you give her the wisdom as she grows up to know you? We want you to be her guide. We want you to be her strength, you to be her standard. And that's really important. So, you know, this service isn't really been about, it's not quite a christening, because a christening and baptizing a child kind of implies that they've received salvation from God simply by what we do or say. But she's going to make her own mind up one day in the future when she's old enough to really understand what it's all about. So we just bring her as Jesus was brought to the temple by his parents as a young child, in the hope that his life would be of service to God. So we take the opportunity to bring Kamila to God now. And we pray and we commit ourselves to giving her every opportunity to find God and to walk with him as she grows. What will you do to support her and this family? So I'm actually going to ask you a question, if that's okay. You don't have to say anything, but you can say yes or yes or do yes. So I'm going to ask you, Kay and Jamie, do you acknowledge the goodness of God in giving you the gift of this child, Kamila Kashanti Webster? Do you accept the responsibility of bringing up Kamila in the fear and nurture of the Lord, so directing your lives and ordering your home that by prayer, precept and example, she may have every opportunity to grow up to know and love Jesus as Savior? Thank you. Well, that was your opportunity to say what your intentions are and why you're here. But I'm going to ask you, as brothers and sisters of the congregation, whether you acknowledge your responsibility as the body of Christ to teach, to train, to pray for Kamila, so that in due time she may come to the knowledge of the Lord Jesus as her Savior. And if you do, and you're committed to that, as a family of God here, will you stand as we now dedicate this little one to him? And as we pray for Kamila, think about your role. Just stand now if you're committed to doing this. Think about, what is your role? What do you want to pray for right now? And just say it quietly as we're praying for her. Or just say amen to the prayer. Think about how you can encourage her, how you can bless her. And think about the other children that you know, that you may have made this promise about in the past. Are you living up to it? Is there something you can do or say to bless them and encourage them even today? Right. This is where I take the mic and put it in here. And hopefully, Kamila will want to come and come to me for a few moments. We'll see. We'll see. You stand next to me. I'll take this mic out of the way. There we go. So, Kamila, I'm going to pray for you. Is that okay? Not sure about this. Take the mic. Here we go. So, I'm going to pray with my eyes open because I like to see what's going on. And I pray for you. Join with me in this prayer. Thank you, Father God, for Kamila Kashanti Webster. Lord, I know you called little ones to yourself. You said, let them come to me. And you put your hands on them and you bless them. And we bless you today in the name of Jesus. Yeah. Lord, will you bless Kamila today? Will you bless her in the days to come? Will you deliver her from all the dangers and evils that will surround her? Will you surround her with your mercy instead? Lord, will you help her to grow up into security, into wholeness, to be a person of compassion, who exercises patience, kindness, joy, love, all those fruits of the Spirit. Lord, will you give her your Spirit to lead and guide her through life? Will you help her through every phase, through all the different stages of life, into her youth and beyond, so that when she's a young woman, she will remember you and remember all the things that she's learned from you through family, mum, dad, through the church, through your word, through your Spirit walking with her. And you'll keep her from the despair that comes when we turn away from you. And Lord, will you go ahead of Camilla so that she may have friends who know you and that she may be a blessing to her friends because she's a witness for you. May she not be engulfed by the materialism, the short-term pleasures of this world and be so consumed with a passion to love you and to love others instead, so that she'll be a blessing. Lord, will you make her a sweet offering to you, that she will build your kingdom here on earth, just as it is in heaven, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So, Camilla, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance, his face upon you, and give you peace, in Jesus' name. Amen. Yeah, that happened very quickly, didn't it? Okay. Right, we are going to pray now for all of you together. So let's pray for this family and friends unit here, represented. If anyone's got a camera, please do take a picture from your phone of this family and all those who are supporting them. So, Father, we want to pray for this family. We want to pray for Kay, for Jamie, for each one of these godparents and families stood here, not just at the front, but those who are represented by them. And we want to pray that they will encounter you every day and discover your holiness, your love, the depth of your love. Oh, Lord, that they will be able to know you. And this knowledge will be so amazing, it will just drive them to you again and again every day. I know you're on their case. I know that you are chasing after them, Lord. So take hold of them. Take hold of their lives and bless them. So don't stop chasing them, Lord Jesus. Holy Spirit, keep chasing them until every part of their minds and their hearts, at home and work, are part of your kingdom. Lord, give them wisdom. Give them wisdom to love and instruct Camilla and to help her through every phase of life so that she'll have your values, your character, your view of the world. And Lord, will you make these people into positive role models for her? And Lord, let your word be present. Let your word be practiced in their family and then in their relationships with one another. That you would raise up peacemakers amongst them. That you would raise up those who are able to provide and give and help financially and help in practical ways with their time, so that Camilla can live a full and wonderful life. And Father, will you provide for them every step of the way and teach them how it's more blessed to give than to receive in your economy. Lord, give them your energy, your stamina, your patience, your selflessness that they're going to need to bring up this child, and surround them with even more supportive family and friends. May your Spirit be prompting each person here, Lord, so that they will know when their help and encouragement is needed. Lead them so that they will have a massive positive impact on Camilla's life and her journey to faith in you. And we place them into your hands in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Bless you. Well, I have got, thank you, Stacey. I was wondering where we've gone. I've got a Bible here and a certificate, which I'll give to you for the moment, so you can have a look at. Searched everywhere for a Bible that I felt was really good, and that one tells stories really well, stories of the Bible really well. Okay, thank you. You can sit down now. We've done our bit. We're just getting ourselves back in the camera, I think. Thank you. Oh, thank you so much for coming again. And it's been a joy to be with you all this morning. I hope the rest of this day goes really well. We're going to just have one or two very short notices now as we finish our service for things that are going on that would be useful to know about. And if you're online, this will hopefully be helpful for you as well. So Entanda's going to put that up on the screen. Thank you for joining us today. I think one of the first things I need to mention is that we have our drop-in day happening on the 22nd. Can you see that one? Yeah, it's okay. On the 22nd. So it's a week on Wednesday. Do spread the word. Tell people that you know who might be feeling a bit alone or in need in some way. This place will be open. There'll be refreshments all through from 11 till 2, and there'll be lunch, and there'll be things to do. We also have a benefits advisor coming on the 22nd, which may also be of interest to some people. Just come. We have a whole variety of people who come who are different ages, who probably never been to Beacon Church to a service before, but just come to have some time together and find out what's going on. Do some games together. We play dominoes sometimes. We play other games. We have darts and table tennis. We make crafts, and we have colouring and all sorts of things like that going on. So we make things as well. So do let people know. It's partly because we want to bless our community, and we want to be here so that there's a safe and welcoming place for anyone to come to. That's a drop-in. And then on the following Sunday, there you go, the 26th, we have a special youth service here where we have our guest speaker, Doug Zembuze from the Roheath Pavilion Church, who's coming to speak to us, which is brilliant. It's going to be great. Our young people are taking part, leading the worship music on that day. So please do invite someone else to come. Encourage any young people you know, young adults, younger teens to come. And we're going to have a great day on that day. It's not easy, but it's worth it. That's the theme. Also, I'd ask you to pray and keep praying for the Beacon Centre project. You see the banner behind me. We're reaching an interesting critical phase in our project where we've got some updates to give. And we're going to do that on Sunday, the 3rd of December, to show you where we're at and what we're doing. We're really desperate to move ahead. We're looking for people to work, or somebody to work for us as a fundraiser. We need lots of volunteers to help us to put things in place, and we'll tell you more on that day. Thank you. Yeah, next week we continue with our the Gospel of Matthew series on discipleship, and Chris will be looking at chapter 17. Who is this Jesus after all? Thank you. If you want to get in touch with us, we've got details coming up on the screen now, where you can send us an email, get in touch by phone, have a look on Facebook at where we are and what we're doing. And we'd love to see you again. So thank you again for coming today. Enjoy the rest of your day, and celebrate a wonderful day. Thank you.